Ray and I heard music coming from this giant ballroom that took up a whole block called the Rendezvous Ballroom. And it was where Stan Kenton from the jazz era and every big band had played there. You name it, they all played there. Well, they closed it. When they tried to reopen it, they lost about $80,000. So they just closed it because the jazz era had gone out. But they were renting it out to the schools for graduation and stuff like that. At that time, they didn't allow guitars. Anybody who played a guitar at that time, they wouldn't allow you to sell tickets to bring them in because they said the guitar music was evil and devil music. So they used horns. They had the horn bands from the schools. So they'd graduate to the horns. Well, what happened was I heard it, and I did a little bit of a flim-flam man talk, and I walked up to the manager and said, my name is Dick Dale, and I just flew in from Massachusetts, and my buddy and Ray, we were asked to come here and play during intermission. And he goes, we didn't hire nobody to come from Massachusetts. And so, oh, yeah, I'm supposed to do it. I mean, there's no fee. I'll just do it for nothing, you know. Well, okay, well, they're on break right now. So Ray and I got on the stage, right? And we started playing our instruments. We asked the band if they'd back us, and they said no. But the drummer says, I'll back you. So the drummer came out and backed us, and I'm doing all this rockabilly stuff, and the girls are all dancing with their petticoats, you know, and that's all those layers of dresses they wore in those days, doing the jitterbug and the Lindy. And they just went wild, whereas before, when the horn band was playing, they were just dancing, no deal. But when Ray and I started playing, and I was singing the songs, they just came right to the stage and started doing it. Well, the band got all jealous and mad, and they pulled their drummer off the stage, and then they said, it's time for us to get on the stage. So they came on. Well, anyway, I talked to the manager and said, thank you very much. And I got a hold of my dad, and he was a precision machinist for Hughes Aircraft. He came down with me, and we made a deal with the owners, and they were called Thelma and Ernest Neufeld, and they owned it, and they says, yeah, you can come and play on a weekend. We'll see what it's all about, you know, because it's closed. But we couldn't get permits because I was playing guitar. So my dad and myself, we had these secret meetings with the Parent Teachers Association, the city council, the fire department, and the police department. And I said, would you rather have your kids out on the street drinking T-Bird? That was a wine called Thunderbird, and beer. Or would you have them in a big building where you could control them? And they go, well. And then they said, well, they got to wear ties. Well, whoever heard of surfers wearing ties? Because I was surfing every day. So my dad bought they gave us the permit. And my dad bought a box of ties. And we gave them to the kids to come in. We charged them a buck at the door, and they came in. I was surfing with 17 surfers, and I said, I'm playing tonight at the Rendezvous Ballroom. It's the biggest ballroom on the peninsula. Come on down and enjoy and have fun. 17 surfers, that was my first audience. And then they go, you're the king, man. You're the king. That sound on your guitar. He goes, king of the surf guitar, because I was surfing. And then there's another story that takes me how we built up the audiences. And we didn't use public relations stuff or anything like that. I just went to the different schools and got permission to play early in the morning. It built up to 4,000 people a night. And I kept adding to my band bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, because I loved the big band sound.